I love Star Trek, which is why I hate
Star Trek.
Yeah, bad Star Trek. And today we're talking about drugs. Drugs, they're bad, right? Yeah, they're bad. Drugs are bad. And we're going to talk about why you shouldn't. Oh. Where was I?
Symbiosis.
Yeah, we're talking about symbiotics. I don't know.
People, this is POS TNG, Symbiosis.
Hey Kim, have you tried these peanut butter and Pringles?
The episode opens with the Enterprise arriving at a star to study it. The star is spewing out all sorts of electromagnetic energy, which really will have no purpose on the show other than that their sensors are a little fuzzy. And that's about it. The rest of this whole intro is nothing but padding, 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 hey!
Padding, padding, padding,
woo!
Padding, 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 padding,
padding, padding, padding,
padding, padding,
padding,
padding, padding,
padding,
padding,
padding, padding. Patty, won't you? So, after a minute of nothing important, we finally get down to it. Hey, Kim, you want to know what this could have been?
Yeah, sure.
Captain's log. We've arrived at a star. It's dangerous, but we're going on anyway because we're explorers. Meanwhile, Wesley Crusher starts detecting some x-rays on the ship. This will mean nothing at all.
Well, at least if it doesn't kill him, it ought to make him sterile.
And so Counselor Troy chimes in very hopefully to say, people are now tense.
No.
Counselor Obvious!
And so they get closer to the sun, and Worf detects a distress signal.
We're heading into the atmosphere. Please, do something. We're going to burn up.
I am T'Jean, Captain of the Sanctuary.
How can we help?
I am no longer able to maintain this orbit. So, you know, dead, I guess.
Tasha Yar suggests that they go with the tractor beam. As if it's a weapon of last resort to use. And so they go with it, and it doesn't work.
Thank you, Tasha Yar, for padding something other than the chest of your uniform.
Padding, padding, padding. Apparently, the ship can no go. I don't think they get it. I'm showing the clip.
We are packlets. Our ship is the Mondor. It is broken.
Data is able to detect the problem, but the Tardos can't even fix their own ship, even when they get the parts.
Will you be cool?
You have the necessary tools to realign the coil?
Do we smoke it?
Sorry, nobody here knows anything about it.
We need help.
So, Tasha figures out a way she can beam them over and tries to talk them through it. And then she starts getting snippy about it.
Mark 2, 6, 8.
Got it.
Hey, don't make me come over there and seduce you.
Patty, 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 patty. They tell the stoners to get on the pad and beam themselves over, and instead they beam over their cargo.
Number one, did you get them off?
Captain, please! So Captain Picard can't seem to understand any possible reason why these aliens would make their cargo more important than the crew. Well, I can think of lots of reasons.
Reading six life forms, but I can't get a solid lock.
We have no choice. Energize. Two are lost, sir. But we saved four.
But the stoners don't even care about the two people who were lost. They only care that the cargo was saved. Instantly, the two stoners and the two effete people who apparently owned the cargo start arguing over trade negotiations.
The goods were never delivered. They were destroyed with your ship.
Hence the deal was incomplete. Hence possession of the Felicium remains ours.
We need it.
I refer you back to Sub Rosa for the mop debate.
Now give it to me.
That's my mop!
Not anymore, buddy.
And so they start a Sith fight.
A sissy Sith fight.
Say that 10 times fast.
Ow!
Stop this. Now!
Well, if the Enterprise hadn't installed those shag carpets...
So Tasha, eventually, breaks the fight up.
Behave yourselves, gentlemen. It's an interesting ability. The question is, how do I defend against it?
How to counter it? Maybe don't let them touch you in the first place? You know, since you have guns? You know, Tasha, if you're this dumb, you're not going to last much longer on the Enterprise. And so, back on the bridge, Troy finds it odd that the crew aren't upset about their lost people. And so the crew members meet with Picard, who agrees that he will give them the parts and the training so that they can fix their last ships. By the way, does this actor look familiar to Star Trek fans? He's David Marcus. What does that mean for the story? That Merrick Buttrick needed work. Moving on. And now they continue to argue about ownership, only a little more civil this time. And apparently it's crucial medicine for a planetary plague.
The cargo you have impounded is the only hope of life for our people.
I suddenly don't like those other two people.
Gee, I wonder why.
That single shipment of Felicium represents an enormous investment. We can't just give it away.
Yo, boy. Looks like these people are Roddenberry's straw men of evil pharmaceutical companies.
It turns out our two stoner people are also carriers for this plague. Which maybe we could have learned if they'd gone to sickbay first, but it's not like going to sickbay is the normal first step. Oh wait, yes it is!
We need help.
So, in sickbay, Dr. Crusher can find no infection, nor any reason to explain all the symptoms that the Onarans, that's the stoner people with the plague, have. Oh, and Dr. Crusher doesn't like the Breckians much at all. They're the effete people who actually own the medicine who refuse to give it away.
No green pox sex for you!
This is crack.
So Picard requests 2 doses for the 2 Onarans' immediate use. And the Breckians agree. 1 dose apparently equals 0.01 milliliters.
Very potent substance.
Let's put this into more relatable terms for my audience. If the movie-going public of the world represents a single milliliter, then a single dose of Felicium would equal the amount of people who actually like Green Lantern. Well, that might be a little high, but it kind of gets our point across. Green Lantern sucked. And apparently this plague also cannot be cured. It can only be staved off for 72 hours with a single dose of Felicium. Are we starting to get what's really going on here? And so the Onarans dose themselves with the Felicium, and Dr. Crusher is able to figure out instantly that the Felicium is not a medicine, but a narcotic.
Then to Jean and Romas, and everyone on their world.
Is a drug addict.
Oh, so it turns out they're not actually evil pharmaceutical straw men. They're just the villains in a really lame don't-do-drugs plot.
She tells Picard, and Picard tells her that he can't tell the Onarans because of the Prime Directive. He cannot interfere with their culture. Dr. Crusher volunteers to create some sort of a substitute for Felicium that'll ease them off their addictions. Sort of a Felicium patch, if you will. And I gotta say, I'm all for Dr. Crusher's plan. Because I know my life's been only better ever since I discovered the Felicium Patch. The Felicium Patch. It'll cure your plague and get rid of all that nasty craving and addiction. The only thing you have to worry about is just occasionally running out. And when it runs out, you just replace it with another one, and you're good to go. The Felicium Patch. Buy it today! Turns out the Breckians have no high technology or industry at all. Their whole planet revolves around making this one product. And they just sponge off the Stoner Society. Are you seeing a problem with this concept? How many long-term stoners do you know who you trust to actually make your living for you?
Okay, folks, if you're ever this guy at a party, it's time to seek help.
What I can't understand is why anyone would voluntarily become dependent on a chemical.
Oh, boy. Now it's time for the Wesley Crusher PSA. This isn't a bad message to tell to people. In fact, it's a good message. Drugs are stupid. They'll addict you. They'll ruin your life. Stay away from drugs. That's fine. Do we need the patronizing message? Worst of all is Tasha's little bumper at the end of this.
I guess I just don't understand.
Wesley, I hope you never do.
I hope you die from an oil stain soon, Tasha. Drugs. Won't you?
John.
Dave's not here!
Do you have it?
So apparently the withdrawal pains are going all over the planet Onara. Just imagine a whole planet crying out for spiders crawling all over me. Well, I got you topped. Here's a picture of spiders on spiders!
Warning. The preceding clip was highly graphic and probably should not have been seen by sensitive viewers.
I'm sorry. You will take us to our planet and leave us there with our medicine or this person dies.
What is up with Riker's face here?
I think even more importantly is where's his other hand?
No!
I will not be coerced.
So, after that little hostage situation goes nowhere, the Breckians decide to meet with Picard in secret. They offer that they're going to give the whole shipment of Felicium to the planet and get paid later.
They know that the Onarans no longer have the plague. They know that Felicium is no longer a medicine. So, of course, they are willing to give this shipment because they don't want to take the chance that the Onarans will lose their addiction. They don't want to lose their only customers.
How would they have known all of that unless the plague had once infected their planet as well?
You know, this isn't even a joke, but here's another possibility. Do we really know how the Onarans got the plague in the first place? Unfortunately, Picard is still bound not to interfere, no matter how heinous the Breckians are, much to Crusher's objections. Dr. Crusher in this episode represents the attitude of basic humanity.
Picard represents rules lawyering.
Ah, but rules lawyering can work for good too, as Picard in the next scene decides that he will also honor the Prime Directive by not giving the Onarans their repairs. The Onarans don't like this, and neither do the Breckians, because they know that after a few more trips, the Onarans will no longer be able to make their drug runs anymore. This will eventually fall apart naturally, and it'll honor the very spirit and the law of the Prime Directive. I gotta say, go rules lawyer on this one.
History has proved again and again that whenever mankind interferes with a less developed civilization, no matter how well-intentioned that interference may be, the results are invariably disastrous.
Oh, Captain Picard, if only you'd remember this little speech when Otto Octavius' wife eventually will come after you for help, too. And so there you go. Symbiosis. It's actually not that bad of an episode. The big problem with this episode is that it's padded. We don't even get the people on board the Enterprise till almost halfway through the show. Really, the cold opening should have ended with the people being beamed on board, or at least the cargo beaming thing. But oddly enough, this show could have used a B-plot. Maybe if Geordi got addicted to Felicium, or if Wesley spent more time studying drug addiction. Something that would have tied into the theme of the show, but still taken some time instead of this long, needless padding that meant nothing at all. In a bit of irony, or lameness, I'm not quite sure. This show was my introduction to Star Trek. It was sort of my gateway. This very episode. Yeah, it started out good enough. Watching Star Trek The Next Generation. Just every now and then. On weekends, maybe once in a while in syndication. Then I was watching it every day. Then I started up on Deep Space Nine. And Voyager. I started watching the original series again. And then the movies came. I finally knew I'd hit my deepest, lowest point when I was watching Enterprise. I need help. So decide for yourself. But as for me, I'm barely calling Symbiosis POS TNG.
You are like, I learned it by watching you.